Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Yesterday, His Excellency President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi inaugurated three significant museums, adding to the huge collection of museums that Egypt enjoys in various domains. Those three museums were inaugurated in Cairo, in Sharm el-Sheikh, and in Kafr el-Sheikh. In order to know more about these museums, we're very much honored to be having with us here in the studio Mr. Mahmoud Abdel Ghaffar, tour guide. Good morning to you, Mr. Mahmoud.
Good morning.
Now, to start with, how do you see the state's keenness on not only improving or renovating the existing museums, but adding new museums, since Egypt enjoys so many treasures? Yeah. And how would that help in attracting more visitors and tourists?
So actually, in the coastal cities like Sharm el-Sheikh, Hurghada, Marsa Alam, that kind of places, the tourists come for the, you can say, leisure tours, for the beach, safari. So we had to add some more cultural activities for them, so to fill in the schedule for the tourists.
Mm. Well, to start with, those museums included Sharm el-Sheikh Museum.
Yes, sure.
And the Sharm el-Sheikh Museum is among the projects that the Ministry of Tourism and Antiquities has placed on the map of openings during the coming period within the framework of the state's interest in opening museums. And the Sharm el-Sheikh Museum is located on the airport road on an area of 191,000 square meters, and the building consists of six halls, a conference hall, a basement, a number of traditional crafts shops, an open theater, and a number of restaurants. Would you tell us more about Sharm el-Sheikh Museum?
So Sharm el-Sheikh Museum, the idea came in 2003. They start to establish the museum on a size like 190,000 square meters, so to contain the galleries for antiquities, food court, and handicraft area for the visitors.
Yes.
So, and the plan was to contain like 6,000 artifacts in the museum, and showing us too many different ages. Mm-hmm. Starting from the ancient Egyptian, Greek Roman, Coptic, and Islamic, and some for the Bedouin lifestyle.
Yes. You just mentioned that the museum includes around 6,000 artifacts. What
Yes.
are the most important pieces of them?
The most important pieces in the Sharm el-Sheikh Museum will be the two heads of King and Queen, King Thutmose the First.
Mm.
And his queen, or his wife, the famous queen Hatshepsut,
mm.
Which was ruled as the first lady in ancient Egyptian history.
Yes.
Yeah, this is made out of limestone with very good colors, original colors. And also, they displayed there the mummified animals, like baboons, cats. And for the first time, we found a mummy for a little lion, the age about 8 to 10 months old.
Okay, mummified, yeah.
Mummified, yes, mummified little lion, yeah.
Okay. The visitors who usually go to Sharm el-Sheikh, or the type of tourists who usually go to Sharm el-Sheikh, the type of tourists who would like to just enjoy the beach, enjoy the good weather, enjoy some water activities like diving, like snorkeling, maybe some safari as well. But now Sharm el-Sheikh offers more to those who come. It's offering also part of its culture, part of its history to those who come not only to enjoy the good weather and the beach, but also to know more about the country. How do you see that?
So I agree for this point, because mm-hmm. some people come to Sharm el-Sheikh like a weekend from the neighborhood countries like Saudi Arabia, Jordan. So, and they have no time, or they have not the chance to visit Egyptian Museum downtown Cairo. So,
and some come with charter flights from Russia.
From England, Russia, Poland, so from many places. So at the moment they need to fly from Sharm el-Sheikh to Cairo, or they have to take like any overland transportation, and it needs like 6 to 7 hours driving from Sharm el-Sheikh to Cairo. So once they have the museum on the side, so they can visit the museum, especially the timing. The museum opens in the morning from 9 to 1 o'clock and open one more time from 5 to 9 o'clock. 9 o'clock.
Mm-hmm. What would make the Sharm el-Sheikh Museum an added value to other museums in Egypt?
So that museum were built on a modern style and display, or which, let's say, the museum presentation is 100% Egyptian unique. Mm.
So should it meant to attract more tourists to the coastal city of Sharm el-Sheikh?
Yes, for sure. This is what I mentioned for you, that the people who are coming for the weekend will be more exciting to come. So they are not coming only for the water activities or the beaches or swimming or safari. They also have the chance to see some of the ancient Egyptian antiquities.
Yes. So how would the projects inaugurated in Sharm el-Sheikh help in promoting the integration of cultural and beach? Because as I mentioned earlier, the type of tourist is looking for fun. He's looking for enjoying the good weather and the water activities. But now he could be, or he might be interested in some cultural and historical activities while visiting the museums, because Sharm el-Sheikh is a very small city.
Yes.
And it has no traffic congestions. It doesn't suffer from the traffic problems that exist in Cairo. It's a small, beautiful city, and the location of the museum is very close to the airport, and that's a strategic location, because it would allow the visitors to make a quick visit to the museum. In what way would it enhance or attract even more tourists to Sharm el-Sheikh?
So, actually, the tourists, when they find a chance like that, even if he has like a transit flight or something like that, it's able to go for like 1 hour to spend some more time in the museum. He needs like 10 minutes of driving to reach the museum, have lunch in the food court, and have a look around the museum, then get back to the airport.
And perhaps that would attract him to perhaps make another visit to Cairo, either during come back again or go back to Cairo to see the other museums that that has more collections.
Yes.
Perhaps visit the pyramids and so on to learn more about
the ancient Egyptian history. Yeah, to give him the support.
Yes.
To look or search for.
Okay. Yeah. Now let's move to the Royal Carriages Museum, inaugurated here in Cairo, very close to us here. And the importance of this beautiful museum and the collection that it offers.
So that museum is a special museum. We have only four of that style of museums all over the world. We have in Russia, Styria, England, and Egypt. And that museum was founded in 1863 during the reign of the Khedive's Ismail. After that, during the reign of King Fuad, around 1922, the museum became like a management royal stable for horses. Then in 1969, I think, became like a garage. Then the museum moved to the Citadel of Saladin in 1983, then back to the original position in 2001. And it was closed since that time for restoration.
For restoration, okay. But we're talking about almost 20 years or 19 years.
Yes, 19 years ago.
That's a lot of time for restoration,
yeah, because it contains almost, which displayed now like 42 carriages. 22 of them came to Egypt as a present, and their other 20 were built here in Egypt.
Would you tell us more about those carriages?
There is a very famous one called Alai carriage, which belongs to Khedive's Ismail, which sent to Egypt as a present for him from Empress Eugenie, the wife of Napoleon III, was sent as a gift for him.
What about the other significant carriages?
There is 5 halls in that museum, mm-hmm. and the most important one, the occasion carriages hall, mm-hmm. which contain the carriages for the ambassadors, the nobles, princesses.
Okay. Yeah. Now to the final museum of Kafr el-Sheikh. Tell us more about it.
So Kafr el-Sheikh Museum already established in 2002. Mm. And they choose that place because it's nearby an area called Puto and nearby Tal al-Farain. Mm. So this area was the capital of the Lower Egypt or the northern side of Egypt during the reign of King Mina, or which known as Narmer as well, the ruler of the south kingdom of Egypt. And Narmer was attacked and fought the ruler of the north capital to unite it between upper and lower Egypt it back to 3200 BC.
And his crown was signifying both
the became double crown, red crown and white crown for upper and lower Egypt.
Signifying the unity between upper Egypt and lower Egypt.
Yes.
Okay.
That's right.
What are the most important pieces displayed in Kafr el-Sheikh Museum?
In Kafr el-Sheikh Museum will be a great couple statue for King Ramses II and goddess Sekhmet, which formed as a lioness head with a human body. Sekhmet was the goddess of war for the ancient Egyptians.
Mm-hmm. What other pieces could we find there?
Also, there's some 2 sphinx and 2 other palettes back to the king Thutmose III, New Kingdom, 18th dynasty as well.
Okay. Yeah. Now, how would all these museums add to the cultural activities in Egypt? What is the value added, if we may say, of those museums?
So let's say it will be target the local tourists and the Egyptian school trips to let them know more about their civilization and history, to be knowledgeable enough about that.
Yes. What are the other museums located nearby, those museums that would actually complement the visits?
In Kafr el-Sheikh, for example, it's the first one in Kafr el-Sheikh. But if you are talking about the Royal Carriages Museum, we have a lot of museums here in Cairo, like Tahrir Square, Egyptian Museum, very close to. We have in Giza the Agricultural Museum. So we have too many museums. Egypt is very rich of museum and history.
So since you are a tour guide, Mr. Mahmoud, do you think that now Egypt can start making new programs and offers for its visitors, whereby they can enjoy visiting those museums, especially if they are close to each other? That would be a special program for the museums?
Sure will be, because sometimes you find the program like 3 days in Cairo, then they fly to Luxor, spend like 5 days on a cruise, then fly to Sharm el-Sheikh. So we have the usual tours in Cairo and Giza, one day for the pyramids and the other day for Egyptian museum. So the third day could be for different kind of museums with the Coptic Cairo or Islamic Cairo. So it depends what the needs for the tourists.
Yes. Mm. How would such museums change Egypt's tourist destination map? For example, there are those certain types of tourists who come to Egypt to know more about its very rich civilization, its culture and its history, and they pay much attention to visiting the museums. Those type of visitors include, for example, the French. They are fascinated by the ancient Egyptian history, the Belgium, the Japanese as well. So with the expected also inauguration of the Grand Egyptian Museum, GEM, do you think that there would be special tours for museums whereby they complement each other, all the museums here in Cairo especially?
Yes, sure, will happen. And I have met before, I have a real experience for English tourists who come every year. They put like 2 weeks for Egypt every summer. they be here in Egypt, 1 week for Luxor and 1 week for Cairo. So that kind of tourists who will care about that kind of new museums with different types or different styles of museum.
Yes. And I would also like to know from you as a tour guide, how would you manage, you know, telling the tourists about those places and even encouraging them to go to other places if their program does not allow more time for that? So how could you know, like, attract them to come and visit more museums?
Each place or each sightseeing here in Egypt has a special thing, not in any other place. For example, in the temples, in the museums, so everywhere has its own unique or its own style, something famous for. So from that side, and even if they have the time or enough time or more days to spend in Cairo, for example, so we can recommend and they have to choose.
Okay. Yeah. Tell us more about the special location of each and every one of those museums. How special the location is?
For Tahrir Square, for example, it's perfect. I mean the Egyptian Museum in Tahrir Square.
No, let's talk about the three museums in Tahrir.
The other three museums. So that one is nearby. The people can walk from downtown Cairo for, I mean, the Royal Carriage Museum, like 15 minutes walking, or by taxi like 5 minutes, so it's very easy to reach. But about Kafr Sheikh Museum, it's a little bit far away in the Delta, so they need to arrange for that before.
Do you think that this would add to Kafr Sheikh as a city that could be turned into a touristic city?
Yes, because they link it between the museum and Tal al-Farain, which I mentioned before, which was the capital of the Norse Kingdom.
You mentioned something about the Sharm el Sheikh Museum and how it contains mummified animals produced from the excavations of Sa'ara. And perhaps that would be a new experience, as I mentioned earlier, for the visitors of Sharm el Sheikh. And this collection includes cats, scarabs, displayed in the Grand Hall, as well as baboons, crocodiles, falcons, in animal, and perhaps this would shed more light on a special part of the ancient Egyptian civilization, how they viewed animals, how was the relation between the ancient Egyptians and the animals, and particular types of animals that were even described as or seen as gods in the ancient Egyptian
civilization. So you can say it looks like a superstition between the ancient Egyptian and each other. So, for example, they worshipped two kinds of animals. The animals which feared them, which were they afraid of, and the animals which they were loved.
Like cats.
Like cats, for example. So the cats, it's a goddess of the tenderness. For them, falcon, crocodile, they were afraid of crocodiles, so so they worshipped the crocodile, kind of getting close to him to be away of their, to don't heed them or hear them.
And perhaps much of the collection that is displayed in Sharm el Sheikh was retrieved from Sa'ara.
Yes.
So do you think that that would be a chance for the visitors to dedicate some more time, if not in that particular trip, in other trips, to visit Sa'ara, because Sa'ara is a very, very rich...
Full of...
Yes.
It's full of monuments.
Especially that it's so many mummies and so many artifacts... Yes, were retrieved from... recent excavations in Sa'ara.
Yeah, so all of them love to visit Sa'ara, even if we didn't find recently excavations, because Sa'ara contained the very first pyramid which built in Egypt, and also it's very close to the capital of Egypt during the Old Kingdom for almost like 600 years. So Sa'ara is very rich and full of monuments and tombs, too many stuff. For us as a tour guides, we didn't finish yet.
Yes.
To be aware of everything there.
Yes.
We need to read more and more and study. And as you see, recently excavations, so we have to read more and study more.
Okay. Yeah. The Sharm el-Sheikh Museum showcases the different aspects of Egyptian civilization by displaying aspects of Egyptian civilization by displaying a selection of artifacts that have been carefully chosen from the stores in El Manyal Palace, Qom Ushim Museum, Sa'ara Museum, Suez Museum, Ismailia Museum, Greco-Roman Museum, Alexandria Museum, and the Egyptian Museum in Tahrir, as well as tours of the city of Luxor and El Ashmunin in Minya. So bringing the artifacts from all those museums across the country and displaying them in Sharm el-Sheikh Museum, what does that mean? What's the significance of that?
They want to collect some of each period. Let's say each age, as I mentioned before, ancient Egyptian, sometimes pre-dynastic, before the first dynasty or before King Mina united between Upper and Lower Egypt, we have some remains of the monuments. So we have Greek and Roman. So as you mentioned, the ancient Egyptian history or history of Egypt is very rich and full of the monuments and artifacts. And as I mentioned, they put like 6,000 pieces in that museum, so they had to collect some from each place.
Okay. Mr. Mahmoud Abdelghafar, tour guide, thank you very much for being with us in today's edition of The Breakfast Show.
Thank you.
And ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned. Much more coming on this edition of The Breakfast Show right after a short break.